And here we have the Panasonic GH5. So hello, so who are you?
I'm Sean Robinson from Panasonic North America.
And this is very exciting, right? A lot of people taking pictures, and this is a big time right now. Like
yes, it is.
Yeah,
so pre-orders have just started. Camera is on sale for $19.99 US dollars. All major photo specialty channels in the United States, as well as our Panasonic.com. You can pre-order it there. It's body only for the $19.99, as well as we've announced the 12 to 60 millimeter finally. A few other cameras that weren't announced during the press conference today, which will all be on display at the booth.
So. The GH has always been like the enthusiast prosumer kind of line, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is the latest. How's the jump compared to GH4 now?
So the GH4, we released, as you guys all remember, the first 4K consumer-friendly priced camera. The GH5 builds on a lot of that with a number of things. Like we've got 4K 60p internal recording at 4:2:08-bit. 4K 30p and 24p at 4:2:2:10-bit internal recording. We've added things like it's the full sensor readout in all different areas. So if you're in 4K 60, 4K 30, 4K 24, it is full sensor readout. You're not cropping anything on the sensor. It still has unlimited record time. It's got dual SD cards using both UHS 2 standards for it. So doesn't matter what card you put in the camera, which one you're writing to, you're not going to have a record limitation on them. Biggest thing is it is 5-axis dual IS-2, so it is a fully stabilized system that pairs with our lenses as well in all recording modes. So whether you're 4K 60p, 30p, it's just going to stabilize everything for you. It also upped the 4K photo modes that we have now with 6K photo mode. 6K photo mode is the density of 6K video, which is 19 and change megapixel, but it only records in the 4:3 or 3:2 aspect ratio. So there's been a lot of confusion out there about 6K and what do we actually mean by it, and it's that it's the density of 6K video in a 4:3 aspect ratio. So if you think like open gate recording, they used to record 4:3 and then just crop into it, you can do that in 4K, in a 6K photo, but it is a hard 30 frame per second.
Can it do 6K video?
No, as I said, 6K video would be 16:9. We don't record 16:9 in 6K. We record 4K using the full sensor and then downsample to, or downscale to 4K.
So that new image stabilization, is it the same, exactly the same that's in the G80?
So with all of them, they're all iterations upon each other. So the GH5 is going to have the newest iteration of dual IS-2 with a new sensor housing, brand new, like I said, new 20 megapixel chip without a low pass filter that just builds on what the G85 did. So like I said, you've got dual IS-2 in it. It is 5-axis all the way out to around 280 millimeter when you're using our optics in the dual IS-2 system.
Can you grab it and show it around?
Yeah.
So is it exactly the same size as GH4?
No, it is not the same size as GH4. It's actually, it's about maybe 10% bigger, 10-13% bigger in that range. Like you can see, we've taken the flash off.
Just basically beefs up everything in the camera.
It's fully weather sealed now down to negative 14 degrees Celsius. So it is freeze proof now. And then probably the biggest thing that I know a lot of GH4 users complained about was the HDMI socket on it. It's now a full-size HDMI, as well as it's got USB 3, 3.1, but on the newer speed standard for
C.
Type C.
What can you do with a Type C on here?
Well, it's for transferring. It does not charge over USB, as some people have speculated.
So like a hard drive?
Well, you can transfer images and video off over USB and transfer it at the speeds that USB-C 3.1 speeds allow you to. Whatever the newer standard is, yeah. But also, what we don't have here with us is we do include a cable lock with it now, too. So you do have an actual screw-in cable lock for the HDMI, even though it is full-size still. So you're getting a lot of that added stability now. Headphone jack, mic input. Much bigger rear screen as well. It's a 3.2-inch screen. It's a 16K, 1.6K dot LG, RGBW screen, so it has the white pixel in there.
Is that like 720p, or what does it amount to?
I don't know the math off the top of my head. I didn't look at that one. Like I said, it's got dual UHS 2 slots. Like I said, they're both dual UHS 2, as opposed to one being one being the other.
You can record to both at the same time?
Yes, so you do have relay recording, you have overrun recording. In stills, for the still shooters, because there's a lot of people that have been asking, okay, well, what else changed in the stills guys? We implemented a way more advanced, from our standards, minimum shutter speed, auto ISO implementation, so you now have a lot of that control for aperture, priority, things like that. We kept the battery the same.
Same battery.
It's the same battery as the GH4. It is a different grip, however. The GH4 grip will not fit on this one due to the slight size increase. And the addition of the toggle now for moving your focus points around. It still uses DFD, but it's a newer iteration of DFD with the newer processor. So your focusing speed is going to be exponentially increased over what GH4 did. So continuous autofocus and video is going to be very accurate, very solid, very quick, and keep on target for tracking, whether you're using face detect, single point, the actual tracking modes, however you want to set it up.
So there's more focus points.
There's 225 focus points now in the camera, as opposed to our previous systems, which were 49. And then on top of it, we've also changed the menu system around a little bit. We've updated it. Let me get it off IA, a little bit easier. As you can see, we've also added waveform and vectorscope on the camera, so you actually get a live waveform. Still carry over the anamorphic modes. Basically, everything you can think of that, as Michael Moskowitz had stated, you guys had all asked for things to better on the camera. Our engineers take those things to heart, and they really sat and hammered on this product to make it what you guys have all been asking for. Said we've got...
So how much better is the autofocus now? How did it improve?
To quantify it, honestly, I haven't had enough hands-on time to actually give you like a solid, like, okay, it's X percent better. But it is, in our shooting with it, what we've had. I can sit, film you guys here, jump right over to the screen there, and it's pretty much like that to jump in focus.
And it doesn't get confused in focusing?
No. Part of what we did is, because the way we work is it's a 480 hertz system now, where the previous one was 240. So it's processing exponentially more information per frame for the focusing data. So it's adding in things like predictive tracking. So now we actually can monitor and tell where a subject's moving through the frame, and then predict where it's going to be by that point, and then use contrast and the rest of the lens optic information that we've carried to actually then fine tune it and bring it right into that point. It minimizes that overrun that you see with continuous autofocus, or contrast autofocus, where it goes slightly past the subject and back. It's almost non-noticeable in this camera.
So it's not going to do the searching thing anymore. How does it compare to dual pixel for autofocus from another company like Canon or?
Well, honestly, I think that the camera is going to be one of the best focusing systems out there. I think for how people are going to use this, and like you guys can see on our YouTube channel, the Lumix Lounge USA's YouTube channel, we posted all the videos that have been shot by Griffin Hammond, Luke Newman, a number of our other content creators from around the globe.
Already used
that
the
they've
GH5.
Used this, they've produced content for it, and we've got it all published up on the website now. Things like Griffin Hammond, if people know him, he was the gentleman who shot Sriracha solely on GH4s, I think some GH2s, maybe a GH3 in there too. He's been shooting with this and did an amazing piece in 4K60p in Manhattan with about ice and bars, things like that. And then we had Luke Newman shoot for 422 10-bit recording with some heavy grading out in Oregon. With some really just awesome, solid content that's up there. Like I said, it's on the Lumix Lounge USA YouTube page, not on the Panasonic and not on the Lumix Global page. It's on our USA page.
So the handheld with IBIS and autofocus is just great experience?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I honestly, when people can get over to the booth and take a look, we've got a lot of setups where you can actually test this and feel it and take a look at it. With any of our optically stabilized lenses, when you're utilizing the full dual IS-2 system, it is...
Is it like a Steadicam?
pretty close to a Steadicam. You know, honestly, Steadicams are still going to be very valuable in what you're going to do. Handheld stabilization will only go so far. But like I said, we've got five stop out to 280 millimeter field of view because of the dual IS system. Where body stabilization falls apart the more telephoto you get and the tighter field of view you get, this keeps it out to that 280 millimeter. So you're still getting five stop, whether you're shooting stills or video.
Does it autofocus as fast as 60 frames per second 4K as 30?
Yeah, there is no change in focusing speed between whatever mode you're in. And that's the same with the 4K photo and the 6K photo modes, where you saw some of the difference between stills and video. It focuses almost identical, I'll say. Because obviously you'll always be able to find some little differences, because video focusing will always be smoothed out a little bit, so that you're not jumping in and out of frame really quick. If you do want to do things like that, we did add in actually preset focus pull in the cameras. So if your static shot's all set up, you can actually select three points and then do solid, repeatable focus pulls in three different points. Which, again, one of those things that hasn't been reported on because no one knew about it. Correct.
So you put the external flash.
Yeah, you can run like our FL200L or any 4/3 compatible flash, run right on it, TTL with it. If you're a studio still shooter and you use Pocket Wizards, you can use the Flex TT5 system now and do actually radio TTL or radio just in general full compatible shooting with it. So yeah.
How is the bitrate in the 60p 4K? Is it 150 megabit?
So 4K 60p, I'll put it in here so I do not mix up on what I'm saying. So 4K 60p is 150 megabit. Cine 4K in 24p in 10-bit is 150. 8-bit Cine 4K is 100. So it's 150 at max for right now.
So 150, that's for 422 10-bit?
This is 420 8-bit in 60p.
And if you do 30p?
30p, you're 150 megabit 422 10-bit at 30p and 24.
So what does it mean, all this 422 10-bit? Why are people so excited about this?
Well, so 422 10-bit is what's going to give you better color grading capabilities. You'll be able to actually shoot with log in the camera. And be a little bit easier on your exposure, where if you're shooting log in 8-bit, you got to be fairly dead on with your exposure. That's actually a little bit off. You really kind of want to overexpose a bit to protect your shadows. 10-bit allows you to actually shoot a little more comfortably and actually be able to work in camera without an external recorder. Later on down the line, something else that we've also announced is that we will be adding 400 megabit all intra in 4K.
Only 30p, right?
I have to double-check the actual specs on that. I think it is across all of them. And that'll come sometime second half of this year. So we have an entire roadmap for the firmware that's being released out. So, things like high-resolution anamorphic as well. So you'll be able to do, instead of 4K, you'll be able to do high-res anamorphic. All in camera.
So
without a record limit.
There's a new chip that does all this stuff inside. There's a new sensor.
Yeah, so it's a new sensor. It's a 20 megapixel without a low pass chip in our new the new 5-axis stabilization system with a new shutter design. So shutter shock is almost non-existent. On par, if not better, than what you see in typical DSLRs, which has never been a problem for the last couple years. When you go to with the processor, it's the Venus Engine 10. So this is a brand new processor for us. So
it's
part of
not in the G85.
This has not been in any previous cameras. So this is how we're able to do a lot of the things. Like I'm saying, the focusing is that much better than what we've ever produced before. Because the new engine is just, it's a beast.
And does it crop the pixels somehow to do this image stabilization? How does it work?
It's 5-axis stabilization. So our dual IS system utilizes the 5-axis sensor motion as well as the optic motion to enhance the vertical and horizontal shifting. So it's still 5-axis, but what it means is your vertical shift and your horizontal shift are expanded on because the optics can move further and shift that image in and keep it in the actual image circle on the image.
Is there also some digital stabilization also happening? Pretty much all of them,
you can turn electronic stabilization on and add even more, some like the in-camera warp stabilization. You can turn that on. In the 5-axis system, it is a 5-axis system with the dual IS
How does it change? That's 20 megapixel, right? Before it was 16?
Yes.
So does that change anything in the way that Micro Four Thirds works?
No.
Or, no, it doesn't
change
anything.
Still a Micro Four Thirds or Four Thirds chip. It is not a multi-aspect like some people have been asking about. It is a Four Thirds chip. We're reading the whole sensor and then downsampling to 4K.
So what do you think is this is going to bring in terms of usage? People going to make a lot of movies with this?
Oh, I think this is going to become one of the biggest cameras for indie filmmakers into the broadcast arena. Because now you don't, like I said, you don't have to go out and buy external recorders to be shooting 10-bit if you need 10-bit. It's got 4K 60, and you're looking at, what is it, upwards of over $5,000 for a camera that can do comparable to what this can do, and we're at $2,000 US. US.
Everybody's 4K 30. So
this is 4K 60 and stabilized internal.
And how many minutes? 30 minutes?
No record limit.
No limit.
There is no record limit
Europe
at all.
Europe still has the limit, right?
No, there's no record limit at all globally.
But everybody globally. Is limited to 30 minutes.
I don't know if everybody else is recorded. I can't speak to that. But we've continued what the GH4 did. There's no record limit and it just goes.
And it doesn't overheat like Sony?
Nope.
For sure.
Sony's 5 minutes.
I honestly can't speak to that one.
You had 100
of those? Not overheat at all.
Does not overheat at all?
No.
No matter what you do. Why does it need to take some time to release the new firmwares? You have two announced
So
firmwares?
Like we said, we'll have a firmware update released in April, and then a second round of firmware update will come out in the second half of 2017.
What is it going to do in April? That's not the 400 megabit, right?
No, 400 megabit is going to be later on the second half. I believe, I got to remember this one right. I think April brings 422 10-bit in full HD.
All right.
So.
422,
and it's still?
422 10-bit.
Or 10-bit.
There's not been any H.265 encoding in Panasonic cameras, right? It's still H.264.
This is 264. The only part of the camera that uses 265 is the 6K photo. 6K photo utilizes H.265. So if you take this off and load it in a computer to grab your frame out of it on a computer, you'll need to work with Premiere or one of the softwares that actually can work with
265. 6K photo becomes an MP4 file? Is that how it works?
They've always been MP4 files.
What do people do with this kind of 6K photo? Why would they be very excited about this?
So 6K photo is going to give you 30 frame per second that allows you to take a frame out of that video stream in roughly 18, 19 megapixel in that area without a buffer. So where most cameras, you know, you're shooting and shooting and shooting and you're at like maybe 11 to 14 frame per second, it buffers out. This won't buffer out because you're recording a video stream. And then in the back of the camera, like with 4K photo, you just select on the back of the camera which frame you want to grab, click OK to save it out, and then it saves that image out. You can also add the noise reduction that we've added onto it to kind of help with some of the video compression noise that you see when you're comparing that versus standard JPEG. But it's going to, so far from what we've seen, like I said, we have samples at the booth that people can take a look at. And we have samples up on the Lumix Lounge, lumixlounge.com. They are full resolution. You can take a look at them for yourself and just see how much improved 6K photo is over the 4K photo original system. And then 4K photo gets 60p now as well.
You also have a slow motion mode, 180?
Yes, it'll do 180 frame in 1080. And it'll do 60 frame VFR in 4K. So you can do 2x slow in 4K. Or up to, I think it's 7x slower in 1080. I think I did my math right there.
So the 6K photo is H.265. That means
yes.
It can compress the file to be not too big? Is that
yeah,
what
the,
it means?
Yeah, the files aren't that big for the 6K photo, because part of it is you're also, if you're using pre-burst, you're only recording a set amount of time. So it's a set amount of data.
So the 4K video still H.264 or 265?
Yes. 264.
If you can do 65 in 6K photo, where is it maybe possible that maybe in the firmware upgrade can let you do 4K in H.265?
Honestly, I can't speak to that one because they don't let us know about that side of it.
It'd be nice to have 50 megabit, same quality as 100 megabit H.264, but in H.265.
Definitely keep asking.
Yeah.
Now, I have a question about that. 265, doesn't that take more computing power as far as like post production?
If you're, well, that's what I'm saying. So this is in 6K photo. This is a photo based system.
Uh-huh.
So yes, you can record a video stream in 265, and if you put it in a computer, it will take a little bit more horsepower to actually work with it.
Right.
But we've built it all in camera to grab your still frame out of it. And it's at 30 frame per second. It's not 29.97, it's 30 frame per second.
Well, I guess I'm just wondering right now if certain stations, like if you hypothetically shoot a commercial, do they play exactly 30? Do they not just play 29.97?
No, they pay 29. So 4K photo, 6K photo wouldn't be as useful for you if you're trying to actually shoot video with it.
Right.
Because it's at 30 frame per second.
Flat.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I got here a little bit late, guys. Hope y'all don't mind if I ask this question. I understood 422, that's internal?
Yes.
Can you elaborate a little bit on that? Because I totally missed it.
So 4K 30 frame per second is 422 10-bit internal recording with no limitation and stabilization active. 60p is 420 8-bit with stabilization and no record limit. And they're all reading full sensor readout, so there's no more crop.
So no more external machines to record 10-bit?
If you want to record 60p in 10-bit, you mm-hmm. do need an external recorder. You need like an Shogun Inferno.
Right.
Because this will do a clean 4K 60p 422 10-bit out over HDMI, but it will disable internal recording.
And it cannot do image stabilization in 422 10-bit.
Yeah, no, it does stabilization in everything. Yeah.
In everything.
There, like I said, we listened to what everybody had been asking. Nothing has been limited on this camera. Yeah.
You listen well. Stuff that we need.
Yeah.
So
how's it going?
Because the stabilization is like optical, sensor shift as well.
Yes.
Sensor shift, so optical or the lens, obviously, isn't it?
Yeah. So.
Oh, look at that.
So there's the sensor moving, half pressing the shutter so that it's actually working.
Yeah.
How is that engineered, the image stabilization? How did they do that?
Probably would have to ask an engineer. I am not an engineer by any stretch of the means.
But because it is optical sensor shift, so there's no limit on whatever 4K.
Yeah, exactly. It's hardware built in, so you're not limited because having to use electronic and then processing power involved with that. This is all optical and mechanical stabilization. Like we said, I know some people weren't here for it, but we've added things like when you're recording in here, we've added vector scope and waveform monitoring in the camera.
What?
So you've actually got a live vector scope and waveform. I can actually turn it this way because you guys can probably see it better.
What the hell? what does it mean, what he's showing right there? What does it mean?
The vector scope?
Yeah.
So this is waveform.
Yeah, well, I could tell you, but it's his gig.
So with waveform, like what we're looking at right here, because we're looking at the logos up there with the bright areas, waveform is kind of like a histogram, but a little more useful for video shooters.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What it's telling you is, in this frame, you have really bright highlights and really dark shadows. But where waveform helps you is it tells you where in the frame to look to see what is actually overblown. And you're able to then take your exposure, and I'll just drop this out of auto ISO for video. Oh yeah, we have auto ISO in video as well as exposure compensation in video now too. So we've fixed it. Like I said, we fixed a lot of things you guys have all been asking for. So I'll drop in here 400 ISO. As I change the shutter speed, you see that you're jumping up. Yeah. And then in addition with it now, so if you're using any of the new lenses, so we reintroduced the 12 to 35, 35 to 100, and then now the new 12 to 60, they have a more advanced iris design than we've had in previous lenses. So that means that when I'm shooting and recording and I zoom, I'm getting a smooth exposure shift now. I'm not getting the step that you used to get with some of the older designs.
Oh,
so
yeah.
It's a much smoother system. Now, it's not a fully stepless iris like you'd find on a camcorder,
mm-hmm.
but it is very, very close.
Okay.
So almost indistinguishable.
Right. So I have to ask you a question. It's something that's on the mind of many of us.
Mm-hmm.
In the past, its predecessor has kind of struggled in low light. Has this changed at all whatsoever?
I've seen 6400 ISO shots that look probably the cleanest I've seen of most cameras on the market.
So would you say the noise is a whole lot more limited?
I'd say the noise is a heck of a lot better than we've ever done before.
Maybe.
A lot of this is what you find because of the new engine, our new noise reduction algorithms in here with video. Said if you look at some of the shots from Griffin Hammond's video, Hand Cut, it's one of the promo video that he shot for this, you'll see really dark, low-light shots inside of a bar.
Right.
Where he's shooting, and it's all handheld and everything, and you're seeing what you can really get out of this camera.
Can, maybe, I don't know, you could answer this. Can it compete with, maybe like with the Sony A7S II? So far, it's they call it the king of low light.
Well, I mean, you're going to use those for different subjects, aren't you? If you really need super, super low light, if you need to be able to see in the dark, and you're looking to actually work with the right product for the job, you may pick the right product for that. We're definitely going to be a solid improvement over what you've ever seen from a four-thirds camera.
Okay.
And most APS-C, and I would challenge some full-frame cameras. Are we going to be at the same low-light capability to shoot at a million ISO? Maybe not. But honestly, you can take this camera, shoot it, and it will be as reliable as every Lumix GH camera has ever been. Never have a heat problem with you, so even if you're shooting at that million ISO and the camera shuts off on you, this won't happen. This, you know, like I say, we build a product, and pretty much any product we've always built, it's built to last forever and never get in your way of production. So it's built to be an actual tool, not necessarily the end-all of end-all in low light, say. So when we go down that path, when you're comparing to an A7S, they're different tools.
They are.
That's the biggest thing I would say to anybody looking at it is they are different tools. If you're shooting where you need super low light, you'll probably own that and this for everything else.
Do the new lens improve IBIS, like the dual IS?
So yeah, there are firmware updates that you'll see with some of the lenses that are existing in the lineup that will update for dual IS 2. You've seen lenses come out and get updated for dual IS, the original system.
It's your name tag, right?
Yeah. I have business cards too.
All right.
Pretty much all the lenses you'll see, they will get updates. They will have all that information as we've, I think it's all fully released in the press release, things like that.
Can I have your card?
Yes, of course.
So.
B2 file?
Oh, of course.
So it's it's available.
Yeah, so pre-orders start today. I know in the U.S. they start today. Like I said, it's $19.99 for the body only. It's $19.99 for the body only U.S. dollars. I know something. Everybody is going to ask. Vlog is still a paid service update. It is a same codes, same things that you use for the GH4 that will unlock Vlog L for this system. So it is not included in the camera from ship.
Is it because there's a license for this Vlog? It belongs to some company or something?
No. Vlog is an in-house engineered thing. Vlog, if you look at our Vericam products, that is Vlog. Vlog L for Lumix. It's just, looking at it with the log upgrades in the camera, it's not everybody's going to need to use log. The camera has it. It's available if you need it and you want to use it.
How much?
$100 still in the U.S. $99.99.
Anamorphic?
Yes, it does 4K anamorphic still.
Is it really?
Yeah. Okay. GH4 brought 4K anamorphic. It was a scale for pixel to pixel. This will use full sensor readout, just like all the other modes. So full four-thirds chip sensor area for it. And then the firmware update coming out at the second half of this year will bring high-resolution anamorphic. Oh, and the one thing that we didn't mention, and the other guy left.
That's okay.
So one thing that wasn't mentioned, and we've been a little quiet on this one, is that in that second half firmware update, the camera will also be given a hybrid log gamma recording capability. So hybrid log gamma is one of the other HDR recording functions. Mm-hmm. So you will have one of the first, if not the first, camera that will be able to record in hybrid log gamma, ready for HDR televisions.
So now we record, we can do 60 or 30 4K HDR with that update.
Because it's just a color profile. And like I was saying, with the color profiles, if I'm in cinema here. So like you said, we've got a ton of them. You've got standard, vivid, natural, mono, L monochrome if you want to shoot in the our custom L monochrome. But we've also added Rec 709. So you have a Rec 709 like gamma curve with knee control. So those guys that actually know about it are probably excited to see it.
That's kind of cool.
He said we've added the auto ISO implementation in both photo and stills with exposure compensation in all shooting modes. We've added minimum shutter speed now in still shooting. So one of the things still shooters have always asked about with the cameras is I want minimum shutter speed. So from street shooting, yeah, it's implemented in this. We've added the ability to take the camera settings from this camera, save them to a memory card, export them and import them onto a second GH camera. So you're able to actually then just carbon copy across. It has Bluetooth 4.2 into it, so you're fully always connected to the smartphone with it. So you can also sync, you can also store your time code onto your phone and then sync that time code back into another GH5. You can sync your camera settings over the Bluetooth in your mobile device into other camera settings.
Can you record with Bluetooth microphones? Would that make sense?
Bluetooth has a lot of lag with it for audio, so you probably have issues syncing audio. But always ask. Who knows?
So is there any improvements of the sound recording system? As you can see, I'm using GH4.
Yes.
Yeah, there is some noise I can hear.
So the internal stuff has been actually pretty well increased. There's a third microphone now built into the system to cancel out stabilization hum, to cancel out button pressing, any kind of like tap on the camera. So that cancels those noises out.
Only from the internal mic.
That's for the internal mic, yes. As you probably saw, we also added now an XLR adapter. So the YAG is no longer compatible with the GH5, YAGH. So the new XLR adapter gives you two XLR, gives you 96 kilohertz audio in 48. No,
96 kilohertz.
Yeah, 96 kilohertz at 48-bit.
So that's 48. High resolution.
Yeah,
audio.
It's high resolution audio. That's the one I'm looking
for. So that's
for.
The first camera I can record high res.
So you got to get the adapter for it. It sits on top. I think the adapter's $399, and it's powered through the camera through the hot shoe. So there's no external power for it. It's two XLR in, independently controlled phantom power.
Without that adapter, you won't record 96.
Without the adapter, you're not going to record 96 kilohertz. No.
What would record? 44?
I think so.
That works on GH4 also, no?
No.
The adapter. So like,
no,
so
GH5
only.
Only. Because GH5 has, if you're looking for those that are super techie and have been pointing this out since they've seen some images of it, there's a fourth pin on the GH5. That's what's the new pin configuration is where the communication's going through. So that XLR adapter is not compatible with the GH4.
An XLR adapter is going to be selling in the US?
Yeah, it's sold globally. It's $399.
$399, okay. And in which month of this year?
So shipping, I believe, is going to happen March into April. So we're still a little bit out from the actual physical announcement of the camera. And all of those will be available at launch.
So this got a lot of things that it used to only available in professional camcorder.
Yep.
Like the 96K audio, the what else?
10-bit, 60p, all that kind of fun stuff is just...
Waveform monitor, like
HDR?
It's going to have the HDR on camera. So
HDR,
like I was saying,
video.
I think this will be the first camera to actually support HDR recording. Right now. I don't think any other interchangeable lens camera has HDR recording.
So your Lumix G series has been improving enormously every single time.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you see yourself as Panasonic, the Lumix series, 5 years from now? If you can come give me detail on that.
8K.
Owners of the industry. We've always taken a very... very customer-focused stance with it. So where we are in 5, 10, 15 years will definitely depend on what you guys and your viewers let us know and create with our products.
Did it overheat?
As what people shoot and
just
keep
now?
Giving
this
us
one,
the
this
feedback,
wheel, I have to shoot 1080 or else it overheats.
Oh, really?
A 4K
we're always
going to
keep pushing forward. I mean,
really quick.
Like they said, next year's
it's not the new one, right?
6300.
6300, yeah.
This is the 15th year for Lumix, and we've gone from a very small company
to shoot
now into
1080 this. Because it will overheat after like 5 minutes. Shooting 4K.
Shooting 4K.
If I shoot 4K after 5 minutes, it just overheats.
How about the 6500?
I think that's much better.
Oh, much better. Oh, these are older models.
They're going to release, it's going to be CES. So, I look at you guys.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Thanks,
we love this stuff.
Thanks again, man.
Of course, man.
Thank you very much.
How do you get the input from all the users to do all these things that people want?
Where we listen.
Do you go on forums?
We listen everywhere.
Google.
Yeah, Google. Google forums, feedback that people provide directly to us. You know, we read the comments when you guys leave them on our YouTube channels. We read the comments when you leave them on product pages. You know, we hear when people are you know, having issues with things. And I think what our engineers have done with this camera, you know, the fact that we updated, and it, you know, it's about 2.5-3 years to update the camera, but look at what we've done in that time to create a new product. We don't believe in tiny iteration updates in our higher end products.
Mm-hmm.
It is when we update something, we're updating it to give you guys a solid, you know, worthwhile upgrade that's going to last you for years.
And two questions. First, when people shooting the video, can you take a picture at the same time?
You can, yeah. Okay. Yeah, if you're shooting in 4K, you can still press the shutter button and have it grab that frame out of it.
Uh-huh. And the video won't skip?
No.
At all?
No, it's. I think we've had that actually for a pretty long time in a lot of our cameras. Just because it was 1080, it was only ever saving a 2 megapixel still,
so
kind of limited on it. But you know, for the setup where if your primary goal is stills out of it, using the 6K photo and the 4K photo are great tools for that. Now that the tracking focus, things like that have been improved, they're going to become even more useful for sports shooters and event shooters where they need all that resolution and they need the speed. You know, but it's still a solid stills camera, which is, I think, one of the biggest underpinning things that we want to make sure everyone understands is that the GH5 is a throwback and a re-push for the actual true hybrid camera. Sure, the cinema guys are going to love the camera.
Yeah.
I mean, that is who built the GH4. But from a stills perspective, we honestly think this camera, when still shooters get it, and you see some of the images that have been created by Daniel Barahuler, people will be blown away to see what a 4/3 camera can do, because it's completely unlocking everything for them. You know, you've got a compact, lightweight-ish system that can go anywhere, and it's a heck of a lot lighter than lugging around a full-frame camera, because you're still stuck with the law of optics.
You know,
full-frame glass still has to cover a 35mm chip.
Yeah, exactly. So, like of a full-frame mirrorless camera, the lens is still the same size. Still have to be really big.
Yeah.
But that's like, this is 60.
12 to 60, 2.8 to f4.
2.8, this size.
We have to buy this.
Sorry,
separate.
Hands are shaking.
Is it Leica?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, so this is the Leica.
So how's the partnership with Leica?
Oh, it's
like
even stronger than it's, I think, ever been. At Photokina, we announced I think what the good word for it is, but the re-up of our partnership with Leica. The head of our division, Yamane-san, and Kaufman, were on stage, and we feed off each other. You know, they are one of the best, arguably one of the best optic companies in the world. And the fact that we get to work with them, and they produce some of the best optics we've ever had, and just really work on innovating new systems that you see in their systems as well, some of the things that they've innovated that you never would have really seen them do as a company in the past. You know, it's a really good, solid partnership we've got going on.
Maybe you first.
How did the engineers work on this? Like, how's the atmosphere? Have you been there in the RD room?
I have honestly not been to Japan yet, to our facilities. I haven't been to our optic plant in Yamagata. I'm hoping to be there this year at some point to actually meet. But our engineers listen and discuss a lot with the employees we have in our different teams around the globe. The United States, we have a number of people in our marketing team and in our merchandising team where we've all come from the photo industry. We've either worked for other imaging companies, you know, traditional imaging companies. We've worked in the retail space throughout this. So we have in-field experience, and we've brought a lot of these things to the company where, you know, hey, you know, listen to what some of these guys are saying, or, you know, check out this forum because these guys are really, you know, hitting on a point that maybe you guys want to listen to. And they've taken every piece of feedback that we've gotten, and we give it to them weekly, and they love it. It helps us build better products.
Do they work like 24 hours a day, or?
I have no idea. I have not been there.
And what's the SD card?
SD cards are dual UHS 2 cards.
UHS 2.
UHS 2. Uh-huh. They'll be the V60 and V90 compatible.
V6 and V90?
The new standard for
faster.
The higher bit rate.
Uh-huh.
Because those are what delineate the minimum sustained record rate. So uh-huh. even though your speeds may be maxed out uh-huh. and they may fall into that V60, V90 area,
uh-huh.
you actually want to have a V60 or V90 card if you're shooting enough where, like, when 400 megabit comes out in the all intra, you're going to want a card like that because you never want to run into a situation where you're panning or something and it cuts out because you just happen to peak over that limit.
And how do we find the V60, V90 card?
So we've announced two of ours that we have displayed down at the booth.
Uh-huh.
I think we have them displayed at the booth.
Uh-huh.
But like everything else, you'll see them come standard across the board as time goes on.
Oh, so in your booth, we'll show the V60, V90 card from Panasonic?
I think we'll show the card. If not, we'll at least show the spec information about it, what the min and max read write speeds are.
And it's above the UHS-2 speed?
Yes.
Yep. So it's like UHS-3?
No, it's UHS-2 uh-huh. is the pin layout.
Pin layout.
There is no UHS-3.
Uh-huh.
U-3 is the top current classification.
Yeah, uh-huh.
V60, V90 are video-specific classifications for minimum write speed.
Write speed, about 300 megabytes per second.
Basic thing is, if you go look at the SD Card Association's website, they uh-huh. have this awesome chart that actually lays it out and says, this is where UHS goes, uh-huh. this is where U3 goes,
okay.
this is where V-Series goes, all the way up to V90 now.
So to record 400 megabit, you might have to use two SD cards in the beginning, and kind of like record to both at the same time. If there isn't an SD card that's fast enough. For 400 megabits.
No, that's not necessarily going to help you because you're recording, if your peak recording hits over that limit, it's just going to cut off. And that's for any camera that you use that uses SD media. The V series just means that your guaranteed minimum write speed will always be X number. So one card and in that system will be fine. You may be able to use some UHS-2 cards that are out now, and you may get lucky and get through with it and be fine with the amount of data coming in when we release the firmware for it. But by that time, the V60, V90 cards will be out, and it's probably better to just pick those guys up.
How's the battery life compared to, because it's the same battery as GH4.
Yep, there's only been a very slight decrease in stills performance, but you know, with how long this battery lasted as it was for video shooters, I mean, hours upon hours of shooting, I don't think anyone's gonna notice any difference.
Mm. So the dual card, it actually you can set it to record to both cards at the same time.
Correct.
4K.
Yep.
422.
Yep.
Both cards at the same time. So
when we go in here.
So then you can have one card for the main and then one card for backup.
Which is
yep,
very important.
Exactly.
Cards break. Even Panasonic SD cards break,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
Really?
I guess.
Okay.
We just have to remember where the action. So double card slot function here. I can set up the different record methods, so I can do relay recording, record same, or we can do the, you select it out, you want photos on one, video on the other.
Mm.
So say if I select the allocation recording, when I come in here, you'll see that I can do JPEG to one, RAW to the other, 4K video to the other, video solid to the other one. If I go up and I change this back to the backup recording, it will just,
same.
You're recording, stills, video, 6K photo, 4K photo, any of that kind of stuff, it'll dual record to both cards.
Same thing on both mm-hmm. cards.
Yep, and that's part of that advantage of having the UHS-2 in both slots. So you're not worrying mm-hmm. that one card will be a slower write speed than the other.
Yeah.
And do you record two cards at the same time, or
You can, if you want. Otherwise, you can just pick whichever one you want to record to.
And once the one finishes, it will go to the second one.
If you set up relay recording. If you're using relay recording, it will, when it fills the first card up, it will then drop into the second card.
Mm-hmm. Or you can record two at the same time, just in case one card dies.
Yeah. That is great. So double external recorder just to have a backup.
Exactly. Yep. Yep. The external recorders will, the really right now, the Inferno would be the great tool if you want to do that 422 10-bit 60p out, since it'll do it over HDMI.
It can't record a USB Type-C to a hard drive, USB Type-C hard drive?
No.
Maybe a firmware could allow that?
Like I said, you just have to keep asking those things and whatever. Honestly, I don't know what the capabilities are of that from that sense.
Because I'd like 4 terabyte recording storage. That'd be nice. Okay.
So maybe cool. I would repeat something.
Of course. What?